بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف اللهم أخرجني من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمني بنور الفهم اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. So far we have studied the concept of Imama and some of the major functions and roles of Imam and how to make Imam, whether it is through appointment by Allah, either selection or election by people. And we talked about the Imam being a person who has a very high position. He is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on behalf of all of us, Allah has favor upon him, Allah has fadl, Allah has guidance, Allah has ni'mah, an'amta alayhim, not because of himself only, because Allah wants this to be received by us. So Allah gives to the hujjah of Allah so that he gives other people. You know, if you give to the leader of a community or, you know, father of a family something, then it is given to everyone else. So it is out of Allah's love for us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for every generation of human beings has a shaheed, has a witness. And alhamdulillah, even today we have this connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, there was a French philosopher and orientalist, Henry Corbin, and he was himself very established philosopher, but then he was interested in a study of Islam and particular Shia Islam, so he used to travel a lot to Iran. He spent lots of time with Allama Tabatabai. There are many question and answer that some of them are published. Wrote books, he compiled books. He says, today, the only faith, the only religious tradition that believes that there is still a live connection between this world and heaven is the Shia Islam. Because if you look at, for example, Judaism, they are waiting for Messiah to come. Right now there is no one. Christians believe Jesus is going to come, but right now there is no one on the earth that connects them. Non-Shia Muslims, the same. They believe in Imam Mahdi, who is not yet even born. You know, majority of Sunnis say Imam Mahdi is not yet even born. Hindus, Buddhists, even they don't have this concept of, you know, God that in the Abrahamic traditions we have, let alone the Hujjah of God. So it's only Shia who believe that we have a person who is among us. It's very important. Imam al-Zaman is not in another planet or is not in a cave or is not, you know, for example, in some dimensions of the world that we don't understand. He is physically among us. As we have in some hadith, for example, in every season of Hajj, Imam attends Hajj and he looks at people and knows them, and people look at him and they don't know him. He puts his feet on our carpets, as we have in some hadith. When he comes, many people say, we have seen this face. Maybe in Hajj, maybe in Arafat, maybe in, you know, holy place, maybe in our own community sometime, you know, he comes and visits us. So he is alive, he is physically between us, he eats, he drinks, he sometimes maybe become ill, he becomes tired, he's a human being. And this is very important, because we have then this live connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are not 100% orphan, although we are Aitamu Ali Muhammad in a sense, but not 100% orphan, because we have Imam Zaman. And as you know, Imam himself said, "Inna ghayru muhmilina li mura'atikum wa la nasina li dhikrikum." We don't forget you. We are not going to leave you alone. And had it not been that Imam has care, calamities, enemies, you know, would have destroyed us. So this live connection is very important. Now, because this is our last session for Imam today, and tomorrow we have another topic, so I want to talk about a hadith that Sunni Shia all have narrated, and then expand on that. And that is the hadith about knowing Imam of your age. Allama Majlisi in Biharul Anwar, volume 8, page 368. He says this hadith is mutawatir for Sunni and Shia. You know mutawatir. Mutawatir technically is a hadith that has been so frequently narrated in every generation that leaves no doubt about its authenticity. But this frequency has to be in all levels. So for example, if 100 people narrate from 2 people, this is not mutawatir. It has to be parallel channels, or many people at all levels. So from our time till we reach Rasulullah, so many people have always narrated this hadith that there is no doubt. And it is not only mutawatir for Shia, it's not only mutawatir for Sunni. Sunni and Shia all have narrated this hadith. For example, Shia sources we have it, in Sunni sources we have it. I quote from Shia sources. Let me read for you also the Arabic. Fuzayl ibn Yasar. This is not in the book. This is in one of my papers on Imama. Those who are interested, I have 7 papers on Imama and Wilaya published in Message of Thaqalain. They are all available online. You can search or go to Message of Thaqalain. So there are 7 papers, Imama and Wilaya, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is in the first one. Fuzayl ibn Yasar says, "Sami'tu Aba Ja'far alayhi salam yaqul." I heard Imam Baqir alayhi salam saying, "Man mata wa laysa lahu imamun فميتته ميتة جاهلية. The one who dies without having imam, ليس له imam. In some versions we have من مات ولم يعرف امام زمانه. So this is the same concept. Doesn't know imam or doesn't have imam. Means imam is there, but he doesn't have imam. He doesn't have leader. His death is death of jahiliyyah. Jahiliyyah is the title for the era before Islam. It's very interesting, you know, many times I reflect on this, that although before Islam, we quickly think of shirk, because they were worshipping idols, kufr. They didn't believe in God of Abraham, for example, or they believed in, you know, a polytheistic way of, you know, monotheism. There were lots of problems. There was corruption, there was immorality, many things. But it is very interesting that when they wanted to put all these things under one title, they call it the Age of Jahiliyyah. It's very beautiful. It means that the main problem is Jahiliyyah. And Jahiliyyah doesn't just mean not to know. Jahiliyyah means not to act rationally. Jahala is not to act rationally. Sometimes because you don't know. Sometimes you know and still you act not rationally. Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam said, رُبَّ عَالِمٍ قَتَلَهُ جَهْلُهُ وَعِلْمُهُ مَعَهُ لَا يَنْفَعُهُ. There are many learned people who are destroyed by their ignorance. His ilm, his knowledge is with him, but doesn't help him. So whether you don't have ilm or you have, but you don't use it, you are jahil. And this is why, you know, in our collections of hadith like Kafi, we have Kitab al-Aql wal-Jahl. After Kitab al-Aql wal-Jahl, we have Kitab al-Ilm. But before Kitab al-Ilm, we have Kitab al-Aql wal-Jahl. Intellect and ignorance. Yesterday in McGill, I talked about rationality. There was a topic, and now it's online, about rationality in Islam and how important it is to be rational. Aql is very important. Now, is embracing Islam sufficient to be saved from jahiliyyah? Hadith says no. You can be a Muslim and still die like the people who were in the time of jahiliyyah. من مات وليس له إمام or من مات ولم يعرف إمام زمانه. His death is death of jahiliyyah. Then Imam Baqir alayhi salam said, and this is a bishara for mu'minin, من مات وهو عارف لإمامه. And the one who dies while he has ma'rifah of his imam, he knows his leader, he has a way to connect through imam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You remember the example I gave you, like an airplane which is connected or disconnected, a radio which is connected or mobile phone which is connected or disconnected. There's a big difference. من مات وهو عارف لإمامه لم يضره تقدم هذا الأمر أو تأخر. It doesn't harm him whether Imam al-Zaman comes soon or later. If you are connected to Imam al-Zaman, now you can be connected and benefit from Imam al-Zaman. If you are not connected, even Imam al-Zaman comes, your situation is not going to be better. Maybe becomes worse. Because when Hujjah of Allah is there and we are continuing the same lifestyle as before, it means it's worse. Whenever Allah gives you a ni'mah and you don't change and benefit from ni'mah, you become worse. The people who didn't act properly before Quran was given and after Quran was given, they are not the same. نُنَزَّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. Quran is shifa, Quran is rahmah, Quran is nur. But for the people who are zalim, who are unjust, oppressors, those who don't act upon the Quran, Quran will add to their loss. Okay? Imagine, you know, if someone is living, for example, in a holy city, a person who lives in Qom or Mashhad or Karbala or Mecca and Medina, and he is not saying his prayer, he's in a much worse situation than a person who lives far away. Because when you are near and you are not benefiting from the presence of Ma'soom, it means that there is a kind of hardness, kasawa, in the heart. Anyway, Imam says, "Man mata wa huwa arifun li imamihi lam yadhurruhu taqaddama hadha al-amr aw ta'akhkhara. Wa man mata wa huwa arifun li imamihi." Let us tell you something more. If someone dies and he knows his imam or she knows her imam, kana kaman huwa مَعَ الْقَائِمِ فِي فُسْطَاتِهِ. Is like the one who is with Imam Ajallallahu ta'ala farajuhu sharif in his tent. So here we don't have any issue of distance or time. Time is not a barrier between mu'min and his imam, between mu'min and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A space is not also a barrier. You can be 1,000 miles away, 10,000 miles away, and be with them. And you can be physically close, but thousands of miles away. You know the story of Uwais Gharani. Yes? Uwais was someone who was not able to meet Rasulullah, but he was very good person. And it is said that he always wanted to go from Yemen to see Rasulullah, but because of his mother, he was not able. Once his mother gave him permission and said, you know, you go to Medina and come back quickly. When he went to Medina, Rasulullah was not there. And because he wanted to keep his promise, without seeing Rasulullah, he didn't stay, say, okay, let me stay, Rasulullah comes back. He went back. And Rasulullah, when he arrived in Medina, it is quoted that he said, "I smell the fragrance of heaven from Yemen." So he never saw Rasulullah, he never met Rasulullah, but he's connected. In Farsi, we have a poem which says, "Ba mani dar Yemeni pish mani." Ba mani, if you are with me, even if you are in Yemen, you are close to me. Ba mani dar Yemeni pish mani, bi mani pish mani dar Yemeni. But if you are not with me, even if you are with me, you are in Yemen. Okay, so distance is not an issue. From here, you turn away to Karbala, to Najaf, to Rasulullah. You can get connected. The main thing is your heart must be connected. And you can be next to Zari and be separate. The same is with time. One of the companions of Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam, after one of the battles, he said, I wish my brother was with us, because he could also be witnessing the victory. Then Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam said, Ahava akhi ka ma'ana. If you want to, it is in Nahj al-Balagha, also in Bihar al-Anwar. And the text is this, that after Jamal, one of the companions said, وَدَدْتُ أَنَّ أَخِي فُلَانًا كَانَ شَاهَدَنَا لِيَرَى مَا نَصَرَكَ اللَّهُ بِهِ عَلَىٰ أَعْدَائِكَ. I wish my brother so and so was here to see the victory that Allah has given you. Amir al-Mu'min said, أَهَوَىٰ أَخِيكَ مَعْنَا. Is his desire with us? Does he want to be with us? Does he think like us? Does he have the same ideals like us? قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said yes. Then Amir al-Mu'minin said, فَقَدْ شَهِدَنَا. So he was shahid, he was present, he was witness with us. And not only him. So his brother is alive, but in another place. So Amir al-Mu'minin says, a space is not making any barrier. Distance is not a barrier. Then Imam Ali goes to the time. وَلَقَدْ شَهِدَنَا فِي أَسْكَرَنَا هَذَا قَوْمٌ فِي أَسْلَابِ الرِّجَالِ وَأَرْحَامِ النِّسَاءِ سَيَرْعَفُ بِهِمُ الزَّمَانِ. Not only your brother who is alive, but not here. There are people who have not yet been born. They are present today. They are with us. Time is going to bring them later. سَيَرْعَفُ بِهِمُ الزَّمَانِ وَيَقْوَى بِهِمُ الْإِيمَانِ. Iman is going to be strengthened by them. So today we can be a participant in the battle of Jamal. We can be a participant in Karbala. When you say, Ya laytani kuntu ma'akum fa'afuza fawzan adima, this is not just a wish that, you know, every person can have some wishes. This is a reality. If someone says this honestly, then he would be included. So, the hadith says, مَنْ مَاتَ وَهُوَ عَارِفٌ لِإِمَامِهِ كَانَ كَمَنْ هُوَ مَعَ الْقَائِمِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ فِي فُسْطَاتِهِ. In another hadith, Imam Sadiq, this was from Imam Baqir alayhi salam, he says, the narrator says, ابْتَدَأَنَا أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ يَوْمًا. ابتدأنا. You know, sometimes hadith are after a question. Someone says, سَأَلْتُ أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. I asked, and Imam answered. But this is hadith that Imam initiated the talk. You know, so Imam wanted to give this message. ابْتَدَأَنَا أَبُو عَبْدِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ يَوْمًا وَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ مَاتَ وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ إِمَامٌ فَمِيتَتُهُ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً فَقُلْتُ قَالَ ذَلِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Then he says, when Imam said this, I said, this is said by Rasulullah. Although Imam already had said this, but he asked again. فَقَالَ إِيْوَ اللَّهِ قَدْ قَالَ. By Allah, Rasulullah said this. قلت فَكُلُّ مَنْ مَاتَ وَلَيْسَ لَهُ إِمَامٌ فَمِيتَتُهُ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً قَالَ نَعَمْ. It was difficult for him to accept this. Maybe for many of us it's also difficult to accept. How a person who is praying and fasting and maybe going to even Mecca, Medina, how we can say that he is a person that if he dies, dies in the time of Jahiliyyah. There are a few points. Our time is very limited, unfortunately. One is why it says man mata. Why it doesn't say the one who doesn't have imam or doesn't know his imam? Why it says man mata? Because maybe some people in some part of their life they don't have this ma'rifah. There is no problem if they quickly recover and sort the problem out. As long as we have opportunity, we have to sort out. But if someone dies in this condition, when you die with it, it is fixed. You know, when you die with a quality, it means that then there is no way to change it. So the emphasis is make sure that before you die, you have this. Not in the sense of saying, okay, let's delay and delay. I'm still, you know, going to be there. No, in the sense that never say it's late. Quickly go back. As long as you are alive, it means that Allah has given you opportunity. Don't say, you know, no, for me it's too late. How can I, you know, now change? So, this is one point. The second point is ma'rifatu imam zamanihi, or having imam of his time, something that we Shia can say, we have it? Maybe some Shias or many Shia think that, alhamdulillah, we know imam of our age, so we are not like that. But I don't think it's enough. What does it mean to know imam of your age? If it was just enough to know the name of imam and his date of birth and who is his father, his mother, and when he's going to come back, and it has no impact on your life, then what is making your life not the life of Jahiliyyah, or your death not the death of Jahiliyyah? You have to show me what impact knowing Imam Zaman has had on your life. And now every one of us as individual and community should investigate. Can I say there are some signs of believing in Imam Zaman, a living imam, a living leader in my life that makes my life different from someone who doesn't have Imam Zaman? What is the difference? Is it just reciting Dua Faraj, saving our life from Jahiliyyah? So no matter what we do in life, just to recite Dua Faraj is enough? Recite Dua Ahd is enough? Or these are things to connect you to Imam, but so that you follow Imam. What is the following today? If we don't follow Imam, if we act as if we don't have any leader, then it means that we are also not saved from Jahiliyyah. So we have to really define for ourselves what following of Imam of our age requires from me and my community today in this context. What am I doing for my imam and for his causes? Is my study life, is my business, is my family life, my community life, my social interactions, are they showing that I have received something, some guidance from imam that other people don't have? Otherwise, it means that I am Jahiliyyah, in the time of Jahiliyyah. So, this is something that every person has to think about it. I mentioned just 2-3 points, and maybe then if you have questions, you know, we can expand on this. First of all, ma'rifah of Imam has to be very intimate. Ma'rifah. If you just know there is someone in some place who is called so and so, in Arabic they don't say ya'rifuhu. No. When you say I have ma'rifah about someone, it means that you have very personal, intimate information. This is the difference between arif and alim. Alim knows that God exists. Alim knows that God is knowledgeable, powerful. But arif has personal relation with Allah. He lives with Allah. Allah is always with him. He walks, he eats, he drinks, even he goes to sleep, always thinking of Allah. There is a personal relation. Just knowing that there is Imam Zaman is not enough. You have to have ma'rifah. So you have to think a lot about Imam Zaman and combine your information with love. So thinking about Imam should be always in our mind. Our heart should beat with remembrance of Allah and His Hujjah. You start your day with Dua Ahd. You remember Imam. It's not only every Jum'ah we have to remember Imam in Dua, not but every day we have to start the day with remembrance of Imam, but also throughout the day. Imagine if someone is working for an organization and only once a week remembers that organization, or just in the beginning of the morning remembers the organization, but rest of the day he does his own things. So they don't accept him. If you are part of any organization, if you are part of any party, any group, any camp, so you have to always remember that you have some duties, some responsibilities towards that entity. Never forget it. So we should increase our ma'rifah of Imam Zaman. Very personal ma'rifah plus love. But also you should know your time. You know, let me give you this example. Imagine if I am working for one organization and I am responsible for marketing. They send me to Montreal. Say, you know, you go to Montreal, you work for us for marketing. Is it just enough you know your organization, you know your ideals, you know your aims, your objectives, your history, everything about your organization? It's not enough. You have to try as much as possible information about Montreal. Yeah, because then you want to know how you can serve your organization here. You should know mentality of people here, you should know opportunities here. If there are other companies with the same product who are competing with you, you have to know their strategy, their tactics. Who are the people with whom you can do some business? Who are the people that you have to keep away from them? This is part of knowing your job. So knowing Imam Zaman is not just something very abstract. Something that even the Shia of 1,000 years ago knew about Imam Zaman. Most of us today even don't have information that Sheikh Tusi has written in his book about Imam Zaman. Nu'mani has written in his book about Imam Zaman. But even if you have all that information, it's not enough. Because you want something for today. Leadership for today. So knowing Imam, knowing your time, knowing your challenges today, opportunities today. Who are with my Imam today? You are not alone. It's not, you know, a personal thing. It's not an individual thing. This is collective. Who are with your Imam? Who are the people who are concerned with the aims and ideals of Imam? Who are the enemies? You know, a Muslim, a mu'min, should always have few things in mind so that can put himself in the right direction. You have to remember Allah. You have to remember the hujjah of Allah. Just Allah is not enough. We should know Allah. We should also know a hujjah of Allah. Otherwise, it's mitat al-jahiliyyah. And you should know also the people who are good and the people who are bad. An'amta alayhim and also maghduba alayhim wal dhalin. So sirat mustaqim, for every time and every context, can be identified by remembering Allah, knowing Imam, knowing those who are on the same path, and knowing the people who have gone astray from the path, so that you can put yourself in the right direction. If you miss any of these, then there's a chance that you miss the right path. You have to know maghduba alayhim. Who are maghduba alayhim today? Who are zallin today? Who are with alladhina an'amta alayhim today? Then inshallah you can find your direction. So this is a journey that no one can go on his own. Like, you know, when you want to go to Hajj, you don't go alone. It's a very, very big risk if someone goes for the first time to Hajj alone. Even if nowadays, even if you have been 10 times there, if you go alone, it's a very big risk. But Hajj compared to this is nothing. It's just a piece of cake compared to the challenges of Akhir al-Zaman. Hadith says in Akhir al-Zaman, there are people who يُصْبِحُ مُؤْمِنًا وَيُمْسِي كَافِرًا. They start their day with Iman and they end their day with Kufr. Or يُمْسِي مُؤْمِنًا وَيُصْبِحُ كَافِرًا. Overnight they lose their Iman. So many voices, so many noises, so many pressures, so many distractions. To remain on the right path and be focused is not easy. You need people who have the same mentality and get together. I always emphasize on being united, as in the lectures on collective nature of wilaya. You know, if you have not listened to those lectures, please listen. Collective nature of wilaya. To see how wilaya means to be together and working together. So, knowing your Imam, knowing your time, knowing your context, people with the same understanding that you have in any part of the world, people who have opposite understanding, people who don't belong to any of these two camps, but there is a chance of winning them, attracting them, you should all know all these things. But this needs sincerity. This needs purity of intention. If there is ego, sooner or later it comes out. For Shaitan, it took 6,000 years to come out, but it came out. Me and you don't have 6,000 years to hide our ego. It comes out much sooner. We have to fix that problem. You know, some people say, When Imam Zaman comes, of course I'm going to follow him and I'm going to obey him. Today I cannot, you know, follow our leaders, our maraji, our ulama, because they are not ma'soom. When Imam Zaman comes, I'm definitely going to follow him. But this is only kalimatun huwa qailuha. This is what they say. Actually, for those who have ego, following Imam might be more difficult. Because you are not in that level that you can understand the reasons that Imam makes decisions. And if then you stand against Imam, imagine what happens to you. Today you can stand against ulama, against your maraja, your leaders, and tomorrow you regret. But if you stand against Imam, what happens? Sometimes, you know, I tell people who have difficulties, whether it be in family or, you know, in workplace, I say, we are not ma'soom. So we should not expect from anyone to be perfect. But sometimes I also add and say, actually, even if your wife or husband was ma'soom and perfect, who says you can live with someone who is ma'soom? It's not difficult, not easy to live with ma'soom. Because when there is impurity, then to live with someone who is impure is easy. You know? At-tayyabatu lil-tayyabin wal-khabithatu lil-khabithin. So if you want to be a good follower for a pure and ma'soom, infallible imam, you have to also become pure. Why only 72 people were able to be with Imam Hussein? Why they were filtered and filtered and filtered? If Imam Hussein was a lower leader, maybe he could have, you know, much more. But when Imam was in the peak of purity and he had nothing from dunya in his mind and he was ready to give everything for the sake of Allah, that was the time that only 72 people were able to show their loyalty. And Imam said in the night of Ashura, I don't know of any companions better and more loyal than my companions. Yes, if it is Imam Ali alayhi salam and being, you know, Khalifa in Kufa, then tens of thousands of people can claim that we are follower. But when it comes to Karbala, then 72. So when you want to be really following Imam and ready for every sacrifice, then number drops. So ma'rifah of Imam is not something theoretical, something abstract, something just written in the books. Ma'rifah of Imam should govern our life, should change our way of thinking, planning, networking, prioritizing. We don't have enough of time, enough of resources. We have to prioritize. How do you prioritize? Based on your interest, based on your convenience and comfort, or based on what Imam wants from us? Let me stop here. I was not able to finish this discussion, but I don't want also to take time of your question, sir. I just pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to increase our ma'rifah of himself, his awliya, and to increase, inshallah, our love for himself and his awliya, and to give us the wisdom to understand what's the best thing that we can do for ourselves, for our family, for our community, for humanity. What is the best thing that we can do to help Imam Zaman? What are the most important thing that we can do to unite ourselves? How we can get rid of our selfishness and ego? May Allah inshallah help us to understand and inshallah impediment what we understand. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.